Lawyer.se, video game lawyer company. And this is the title of this session. Good reasons to use a video game lawyer. We'll talk about when to use a lawyer and when not to. And we will hear some horror stories from real life, from the lawyer.
I'm the horror story.
He's been doing this for a while, so there'll be some stories. And also some useful stuff that you can think about when trying to do lawyering stuff yourselves. So, do you need a lawyer or not? That depends. Do you want to make money, as much money as possible? Maybe you don't want to get sued. Maybe you want to protect your rights. And you might like to sleep well at nights and just focus on what you're the best at. So, these is the questions. Anyway, we're so glad you're here today, and we hope you will find this session meaningful. And think about questions. We will leave 10 minutes. That depends how much you talk for questions. Just a brief presentation. I'm the president of Lawyer.se. I'm level 40 on Pokemon. Otherwise, I'm not a gamer at all. I'm a film producer originally. I have my own film production company beside this this thing I'm doing with Lawyer. So I produce documentaries, feature films, and TV series also. With Lawyer, I'm the chairman of the board, and I'm doing business management. So this is me. I live in Uppsala, by the way, and this is the lawyer.
Good evening, Las Vegas. Can you hear me? I feel like a show artist with these heads are going on here. Well, I'm the lawyer. I've been doing video game contracts for 20 years. Got a Swedish law degree from Uppsala, an American law degree from Washington College of Law, American University. Got a bar exam from New York. Got this law firm, running that for 17 years. And I speak very fast. If I speak too fast, you stop me and ask me to try to talk slower. My speed works perfectly in Jämtland, where I'm born and raised, and in New York. Anywhere else in the world, it's too fast.
We have been trying to practice to make him speak slower these last days.
I am Tommy from Sweden. And I'm an attorney. I do the contracts. I don't play games. And I'm level one on Pokemon Go.
But you accidentally turned level two yesterday.
Yeah, by mistake. And I live in Åre. I'm a skier. And I ski 150 days a year or so in a good year.
Mm. We have a lot of clients. They're all in the video game sector. We have currently about 75 different clients that we work with at this moment, all within the same field.
I think quite a few here in Skövde, and probably a few here as well in the audience, and so on. So,
yeah, so I have already said this, haven't I? What we will do today. So I think we'll listen to what is Lawyer.se doing?
So really what we're doing, what I'm doing here is first of all give legal advice to the clients. A lot of times when the client approaches us, me, they have some question regarding maybe a business deal pending, or maybe regarding a game, some issues regarding maybe copyrights, ownership, publishing, self-publishing, or go to a publisher. And first of all, I advise them if they ask for my opinion based on my 20 years in the industry. This industry is very legalized, a lot of contracts. Our bread and butter in this law firm is contract negotiations, anywhere from AAA contracts with publishers, when you negotiate with EA, Activision, Microsoft, Warner Brothers, you name it. But it can also be other contracts. Even if you don't do AAA games, you might be negotiating with some, might be for maybe a publisher for a smaller game, for a mobile game. You might be negotiating maybe with a distributor to distribute your games in certain regions that you can't reach yourself, maybe China or somewhere in Asia. Sometimes we do help our clients draft contracts from the scratch when they need it for employees, contractor, NDAs, license agreements. Sometimes when you're negotiating with a bigger party, like maybe with Epic for Unreal, or maybe for with a publisher for game publishing agreements, then we normally get contract, the draft template from the other party. And then our job is to renegotiate, do red line markups, and strike the worst evil clause in the contract. And a friend of mine, an attorney with a publisher, said once that most publishers add quite a few, maybe 10, 15, 20 evil clauses in the contracts, just to make sure you're awake. If you don't find those clauses and strike them, you're stupid. So it means all contracts are made to be renegotiated. Nothing is set in stone. All contracts can be changed. And this industry, there's a lot of legal contracts going on. More and more, it might be ancillary rights, whereby the game itself can be licensed for other uses. I mean, Annette, I'm playing Pokemon Go, whereby in Tokyo you have a Pokemon store, and they sell all the Pokemon-related items, like candy and T-shirts and sweaters and bags and earrings and what have you. So there's a lot of ways to capitalize on your product. And if you have a good partner, or if yourself are good doing it, you can, by ancillary rights and merchandise contracts, make more revenue for your game. And also, a lot of times, the contracts evolves around IP ownership. Who should own the game? You, or the investor, publisher, distributor, or what have you. So that's what we do every day and most nights as well.
Important stuff. Yeah, so why would you need external help? And what can you do yourself? We'll talk later about what you can do yourself. First of all, why do you need external help? That's quite easy to say, because you don't build your own car, you don't make your own shoes.
You do. I try to.
You need to take help from specialists sometime, because it's worth it.
So, I mean, in my experience, the last 20 years, things can happen if you're not prepared, you have not thought about your rights, your goals, your position, what you're entering into. And there are, unfortunately, quite a few horror stories in this industry happened to people close to us. Currently, a big studio was once small, and in the startup somewhat 20 years ago, they were looking for a publisher for the game in the United States. And they didn't have enough contacts, they were kind of a startup. So someone advised them, get an agent. The agent will help you find a publisher. And normally, agent takes a percentage, maybe 5%, 10% on your first contract with that publisher. But then you can, you know the publisher, and you can negotiate on your own. So that studio, being a startup, they made some phone calls. They found an American agent who seemed to be good. So they signed a contract with him, a big contract, a lot of pages. Didn't understand much, but it's an agent, so how bad can it be, right? So he signed the contract with the agent. He found a major, big publisher. They signed a contract, and the game was a huge hit, and everyone was happy. And after a couple of years, it was time to do the sequel. And saying, like, perfect, now we got the publisher, the game's a hit, now we can negotiate on our own. It's going to be perfect, right? So he started negotiating, and deal was done. And then the agent called, oh, by the way, it's the agent here again. I want my percentage. What percentage? Look at the contract. I have a percentage on every game in this franchise. So that was a major problem for them. And they had out that agent for a buyout, and it was not cheap at all. So even if you negotiate yourself, read through the contract, ask questions, make sure that there's no hidden devil clauses.
It's easy to miss something.
Pardon?
It's easy to miss something.
It is, though, especially in American English contracts. It's been very, you know, hard to read, hard to understand. Also, it happened, it's a true story, a while back. A studio was so eager to make a game about a certain rock group that was the dream project. So they were negotiating with the record label to do the game. And they didn't really get to sign the contract, but there were some few things missing. But they said, let's do a handshake, let's work anyways. So they started doing that game for about that rock group with understanding of the record label, but they had no contract. And halfway through the production, the record label changed their CEO. So a new manager came in to record label, looked into the record label saying, what's this? Someone making a game here based on our rock group here, but there's no contract. I don't like this. So he called the studio saying, please stop working on the game. We don't like this. You have no contract. So like 1 year of work for nothing. And they tried to solve this. So we need to get an attorney here to negotiate on our behalf and solve this game here. So they went to a local chamber of commerce in the city in Sweden where they lived. Because, you know, chamber of commerce, I mean, that's where the important people are members, right? Attorneys and auditors and so on. So they called the chamber of commerce, said, yeah, we have our member on the board here. It's a fantastic attorney. Call him. He will help you. So they called him. He said, sure, I can take this case here. It will cost you a bit of money, but I can help you. So he took the case, and he started calling the record label, and they had meetings for like 3 months, 6 months. Nothing happened, and eventually the studio talked to somebody about the attorney. Said, nothing happening here. He doesn't seem to understand what we're doing here. And someone said, well, you know, that attorney, he specialized in building houses, house contracts. Doesn't know anything about IT, about video games at all. So there was no help. And eventually, I mean, everything fell through. No game, no nothing, and a year and a half spent on nothing. Another thing, when you make games, you normally, in the beginning of the game, you have placeholders. You can't do all the characters, all the objects. Originally, you put in a picture taken somewhere from a film or from online or a magazine to show the mood and the feel and look what's supposed to be of a character. Well, that was done by a major studio a few years back. Sent that when they did a pitching material to the major publisher. And the publisher called them back right away. You cannot do this. You got to delete this, destroy all the material at once because you have added pictures of a certain famous actor, and he's known for suing anybody using his name. So even though this is not a contract yet, but if you land a contract using his name and likeness to get the contract, then he might sue you. Also, there were no game because the publisher was too afraid to work with a developer not having control of rights or third-party rights.
You have to think about everything, don't you?
So a lot of things can happen.
Do you do some contracts? Yeah,
and also here, one studio was doing a game supposed to be setting in today's time and age in New York. So they went to New York with cameras to photograph buildings, walls, streets, lampposts, to get the look and feel of New York to put into the game. And in one alley in Chinatown, they found this fantastic graffiti tag that was so cool. said, this could be perfect for one of our levels in our game. It would be fantastic to set the mood for the game and be like the underworld. I mean, New York with, you know, with mobsters and Chinatown and drugs and crime and what have you. So he did this, like 1 week of scouting in New York, came back, did programming for 2 or 3 weeks, put that fantastic tag on the walls in a scene, in a level of the game, sent the milestone delivery to the publisher, who said, stop, you cannot do this. But even the graffiti tag is illegal, someone has copyright on the illegal tag. Hmm. So in the past, we have been sued by graffiti artists doing illegal tags that we had copied in the games. So you had to scrap those 3 weeks of programming on that level. Mm. Another story is the church. In one game 15 years ago, in the last boss fight of the game, where the good guy fights the bad guy in the epic last scene, the boss fight is taking place in a church. So the good guy kills the bad guy and blood splatters all over the holy place of the church. What's it called in English? It's usually called cool, right? What's called in English?
The choir.
I mean, around when the priest normally to do his sermons. So that was the big, it was a cool scene with a blood splatter on the cross and on Jesus hanging on the cross. And well, it looks really cool. And the game came out, sold well, it was written about in the media. And the church itself saw pictures on the paper. This is our church. They copied our church without permission and had blood splatter over the cross and over Jesus and what have you. So they sued the publisher, who then went after the developer. Secure all the rights to objects and buildings and so on, otherwise you'd be in trouble. Also, if you want more horror stories, not as much time we have here, but this happened also a few years back where you have your employees building a game in your studio and you're crunching, right? And people are a bit unhappy, but you work too much and the game isn't the way you want it to go. And some people start talking about leaving your studio, starting the studio. And some guy, a couple of guys, or girls, leaves the studio. But the rest soldiers on, makes the game. But they don't. Some people doesn't seem to have the right, you know, power and speed and energy. And after a while, more people leaves. And you find out that while employed, they did recruit your employees for the new studio. That happens well. I mean, if you don't have good contracts with your employees and contractors that have been loyal to you and not recruit your personnel and start a competing studio.
You have so much horror stories. You could talk 2 days about everything.
Buy me a beer tonight at the bar and tell me more.
Yeah. So maybe we should move on to what you can do yourself.
Yeah.
Do you think so?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, you don't always need a lawyer. There's kind of two different parts of what we are doing. It's first of all, it's the contracts and the rights and everything. And also there is the negotiation part. And when it comes to negotiations, we have been doing that a lot, helping clients with negotiating.
Yeah, well, 20 years in the trenches in doing warfare. And a lot of times in Sweden, we tend to be very, very naive or very, very trusting. Mm. If you get a contract in Sweden, normally it's pretty fair. It's pretty more 50-50, okay for both parties. Mm. You can read it through, sign it. It's probably pretty good. Mm. But in the US, and this industry is US based, I mean, most publishers are based on the West Coast, US, California, Washington State. And video game contracts are based on film contract practices. And American film and video game contracts, the first draft will not be 50-50. It will be 100-0 for the other party. Mm. Whether it be a publisher, developer, or whatever, but it will totally be tilted in their advantage. So anything, I mean, even if you're great doing games, you're a great studio, doing great programming, great graphics, a fantastic storyline, you need to learn to negotiate contracts. You either do it with an agent or an attorney, or you do it yourself. And doing that is pure business. It's like horse trading, we say in US, or bond handel in Swedish, right? You just learn to negotiate, give and take. And first of all, what's your positioning? I mean, are you in a position of strength, or are you in a weak position? Do you need to get money from somebody to survive right now? Or do you have money that you can last for a while? Can you say no to an offer, or do you have to take the first best offer to survive? That's the first thing. The second thing, knowing what's your position today as a studio, as a contractor, as a developer, and where do you want to go tomorrow? Do you have a goal? Do you have a set plan to how to expand your studio, your career, your skills? Because if you have a big picture, then you can, in the short run, maybe take a contract, but that not be perfect, but it'll lead you on your way to your goals. So it might be one of your first contracts as a studio, you might not get the biggest money, the best royalties, the best working tools, the best IP, but it might be you're getting a first game published, it's a scalp. To have that, then the difference between being a studio with ambitions and a studio with having published games. So sometimes you can maybe take a lesser contract on decent terms and a way to evolve your studio and yourself and your career. And thirdly, in this industry, nothing is non-negotiable. They may tell you this can't not be negotiated. This is a contract signed or else. But everything can always be renegotiated. It's all about what's your position, do you know what you can ask for, and how well do you know the other party? Is it a publisher, a licensor, is it a contractor, is it an IP license company, is it a video game engine studio, is it a middleware company, is it a contractor, musician, whatever it might be, what's their position? What do they want to get out of a deal? Do they want to make a bunch of money? Do they want to own your game? Do they want to enhance their portfolio? Do they have a slot before for a release of a game in a certain time, maybe a year and a half from now? And based on their position, if you know your opponents, you have a better chance to negotiate. I mean, same thing for a buy a car. If you go to the car factory, a car store, and you just got the New Year's model in, and you got a few copies of the old versions of the old model left, they can probably get a good price on the old model. Or if you want to buy skis, buy them in the summer. Because then the sporting goods store want to sell the old skis. Buy swim trunks in the winter.
It's quite difficult to know how much to dare to go forward in
yeah, yeah, and also, I mean, know yourself, know the opponent. And if you haven't done it before, ask. I mean, if you're here in Skövde, ask for your fellow students or former students or here have studios. They can maybe advise you. I mean, maybe a certain publisher is known for giving this but taking that. You can do this but not that. Or try them. Say, we want to own the game, but we can take a lower royalty. Or maybe take a higher royalty, higher advance, but we can give up the ownership of the game. Because maybe it's our goal to make a better game in the future. So this game we can give away to the publisher for a good contract. And then in the next game, we might do our own game, own it. So I mean, you got to know where you are going and what your goals are.
And what's the advantage of making the first contract draft?
I mean, if you can do your first draft, then you control the issues in the contract, what's being the major points. But normally, the one with holds the money is a publisher or a platform owner. They will demand to have their contracts to start with. You cannot make your own contracts to negotiate with EA. It can't be done. But maybe you negotiate with a startup publisher, a startup investor, then you can set your terms yourself. Also, it's a give and take. I mean, what points do you need to win in a contract and what can you give up? What's important for the other part and what's not for you? So maybe the other party wants to have the music rights to maybe to sell the music as an album, maybe on Spotify or on iTunes or YouTube. And you may say, to me, it doesn't matter. I can give up the music. For me, it's not a big thing. But I want to keep maybe the control, the creative control of the game, perhaps. I mean, you can always bargain. Do you want more money up front now to have the studio survive, but you take less royalty on the back end, perhaps?
So it's good to take some time and think about what the opponent really wants and what he likes.
Yeah, and Google, the other party, what's their position? Are they in the news? Are they have a lot of money, little money? Do you have a new CEO, perhaps, and want to make a splash in the market? Or are they pressed? Maybe they cancel a few titles, they need a new title, perhaps? Or might be a new platform, offer you better deals right now because they want to compete with other established platforms, perhaps? Mm. So, I mean, be alert, be active, be awake, and see what's available out there. Be patient, stay cool, there's no rush. Sometimes they tell you, sign now, otherwise we'll pull the contract from the table now, tomorrow. Well, that happens seldom. I mean, a lot of times it's time to think, time to renegotiate, time to come back. And when it happens, as we did that a year and a half ago, a smallish studio in startup in Stockholm, we're negotiating with an English publisher who gave us a deal. Said, this is our deal. We cannot give you better royalties. It's impossible. Sign now or be no deal. And we said, thank you, but no thanks. Next week, they call us back. Oh, by the way, we changed our mind. We can give you better royalties. Mm. Because that studio was confident that we know our rights. We know the game is good. Mm. So if we then don't pay us more, someone else will. Mm-hmm. You got to be confident. Mm. Mm. But if your game is kind of shitty, you know, so maybe take a contract right now and get over with. Do the next game later. Or you maybe had to pay your people on the 25th. You have no money. You may sign now to have money, right? So it depends on where you are. And a lot of things is not about video games, it's about wheeling and dealing. Like buying a car, buying a pair of skis, buying maybe a used sweater on second hand. I mean, you deal. You see, make an offer or make a counter offer. And a lot of times, some people who start as a programmer, graphic artist, do become instead great businessmen. Like Martin Wolfish was the founder of Massive in Karlskrona 20 years ago. He did graphic design. He was pretty bad at it, but that's what he did. But he was the best guy to talk with publishers. So he became the CEO of the company. And now he's working for Egmont in Denmark for acquiring studios. And he's a great, great business guy. Not a good programmer, a graphic artist. He found this right niche. And if yourself, I mean, we have a story here in Skövde with Stavenow. They did great, great games, but they didn't have really a good CEO. And they talked to a guy they knew who was a business guy. And they brought Rickard in, a CEO, and he was fantastic for him. So he came from his business side and brought skills they didn't have. So to add skills you don't have yourself from the outside, if possible. Hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Is that all you have to say?
I can say more in the bar tonight.
You can
probably
say more. What about details in the contracts?
Yes, I mean, first, if you do deal with a publisher, who owns the game? Who owns the IP? Can you own the game and give a license to the other party? Or do they claim that they need to own your game? I mean, if it's important to you, try to own the game. That's the lottery ticket. If this becomes big, this money in the IP for future, for sequels, for merchandise, and so on. And if you try to own the game, you give the other party a license, maybe 2-year contract, 3-year contract, they can sell your game. But have, if possible, a short term. So after a while, you get the game back after 3 years. So then you can get it back and maybe re-release yourself, or maybe do a sequel with another publisher or third party. So then there won't be another game being there out there and confusing the audience with your new game. Another thing being, do you need money? Do you need to get some funding for game development? Or do you have funding yourself, or you can live maybe on noodles and water? And the more you can finance yourself, the better you can make more royalties on the back end. When Starbiz 8 years ago were doing Payday 2, they did development of Payday 2 themselves with own money. When the game was almost finished, they went to 505 as a publisher. And then use a much stronger position to negotiate. Our game is almost finished. We just need a publisher to get the game out to the market. We want more, better royalties. Then you're strong. But if you go, we have a game idea on paper, have nothing, no programming, and I need 2 years of funding to build the game, then you're weak, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, when do people need to bring in an external lawyer for negotiations, and when can you do it yourself?
First of all, can you afford, I mean, how big is the contract? Is it big? Is a lot of money involved? Is it the issue regarding ownership of the game intellectual property, IP, as we say? Or are there issues you need help with? I mean, I think that a lot of times, if there's issues you're worried about, keeping the rights, own the game, maybe you have some issue about payment, I mean, royalties can be a jungle when the other party, the distributor or publisher, first have gross revenue, all revenue to themselves, then they deduct costs for shipping, handling, returns, buybacks, and that can be a jungle. Do you know that those terms for deductions, or do you need help with those? Do you need help with maybe what's a good royalty? Normally you have a publisher saying, okay, you get paid to make a game, and then the game is sold, then they need to earn back their investment. Your studio cost to develop the game and some marketing costs. And then after break even, you get the royalty. So what is fair royalty? Is it 5%, 10%, 20%, 30%? They say, oh, you give 5%, that's market rate. If you don't know if that's correct or right or wrong, ask an attorney, ask someone in the industry that knows, well, normally going rate might be 25% for this type of game, this type of platform. A lot of times it's about money, and if the publisher can make more money, you'll make less money. And they tell you, oh, you only get 5%, that's a going rate, and that might be incorrect, but they say so, and say it very convincingly. And you might think it's correct to say so. I mean, people don't lie, right? Well, in this industry, people do. Well, they say things. The only thing in the contract is binding. They can say anything at the table, and it might be a lie. You never know. So ask for help.
But if you make your own contract, maybe you could just pick something from the internet or just copy some old contract and yes, start from there?
Yes and no. Officially, contracts have copyrights. So if you take a contract and copy it, you might be doing copyright infringement. But so far, no one has sued anybody for contract infringement. I mean, if you have a maybe you can borrow from your incubator friends who have a contract, perhaps, and can take bits and pieces from that contract and add together, do your own Frankenstein contract. I mean, you don't have to invent the wheel. You mean have some contracts, do some bits and pieces, put it together, and make a new contract. I mean, and what's reasonable? What's reasonable with deliveries, responsibilities? Should it be any warranties? Should it be Swedish law and Swedish court? If you're in disagreement, it should be French law. Sometimes people say, oh, we want this to be Chinese law and Chinese court in Beijing. And well, if you get sued in Beijing, it won't be that fun, right? It'll be pretty expensive, probably.
Yeah. I'm thinking about this reason. Think big. Don't forget your long-term goals. Sometimes you're into a project and you're doing negotiations and contracts within that project, but then the whole company has another goal, and maybe it's you have to see the bigger.
Yeah, I mean, where are you going? What's your goal? Mm. Do you want to expand? Have a lot of employees and studios in different countries? Do you have a small team but own your IP? Mm. And does each contract takes you in the right direction? Where do you want to go? Mm. And does a contract help you? Or does it not help you? I mean, sometimes you maybe want to be an indie and do your own IP in 2 years, but if you sign a five-year contract to do work for hire, you can't do that for 5 years.
The important thing is to have fun also, not just to earn money.
Yeah, I mean, this industry, I mean, if you want to make money, you should be working in a bank somewhere, right? I mean, we're here to have fun, and to entertain the world and change the world. And only do work with people you like, have friends, colleagues you like, do games you like, and be, do games for platforms you like. Don't do triple A's and be the 54th programmer on a triple A studio doing the fifth sequel for a game you hate just for the money. It better be like a four people studio doing your dream project, maybe eating noodles, but you love it, you love your life. So easy to get lost in big money, big IPs, and so on. But it's a lot of hard work, crunching, and so on, and taking orders. And I mean, people say, do this, you want to make a little watch on the wall with arms, and say, no, we can do it in digital watch, and you can't decide because you're the 54th guy on the list, right? So, I mean, what do you want to have, a good job, be well paid or for a big company, or do you want to have a small studio or be independent and control your destiny?
I think it's hard to do good things when you're not happy.
It's easy. I mean, right now there are rumors about some big studios now being almost being split up in splinter cells, because the people that after a while, is despite the big money, money's fine, money's good, right? But if you're working on IP you hate and you're doing the fifth sequel and the same thing all over again, you tend to get bored. And we, most of us, you at least, are artists. And artists need to be feel creative and feel free to be creative, not to be locked in. You're on a AAA, you only do tables. You can do like 100 tables for a game. You don't get into doing the characters, any cars, anything fun. You just do the tables.
Tommy and I are an example of that ourselves, because our goal in the company is to keep Tommy and Annette happy. So it's so easy. As long as we're happy with the good stuff. So that's our goal.
I mean, I've been going to be dressed like this with black T-shirt and sneakers and a baseball hat. I mean, I work at a law firm, like suit and tie and working maybe Monday to Friday, 8 to 8, and go to court and be dressed up. And I'm going to be like this. I'm going to work with video game developers at night, doing phone calls with publishers in the U.S., Skyping in the midnight. That's what I like.
So I guess you all agree with that. We have some time now for questions. In case you need to talk further with us, there is a bunch of very nice plastic visit card.
Business cards.
So they're over here. So if you just want to grab one and talk more with us, or you'll see us tonight at the here, also.
Someone want to stump us, say we're incorrect, please do that. That'd be fun.
Yeah. Would you just grab us?
Or have questions about
question,
this.
Question.
First of all, thank you for a great lecture. And secondly, do you get a lot of questions, or lawsuits for that matter, about the likeliness of games compared to other games? Copyright infringement wise.
I mean, we do contracts. We don't do litigation. We don't go to the court. I mean, we help the clients from the first meeting, from NDAs to the term sheet, to the letter of intent, to long form agreement, to the DLC agreement, and so on. We normally don't get involved. I mean, I've been asked. I mean, no one called me last week here. I have a conflict. Can you help me? Well, getting to a conflict when the after fact is hard, like going to a dinner when it's about who pays the bill. You normally want to be around choosing the restaurant, choosing the food, and being part of it, knowing what did they say during the restaurant, during the dinner, who's going to pay the bill. Coming in after fact is hard. But there are issues about the likeness. But for games, I mean, even though for copyright in Sweden and also most of the world, if things are unique, if a thing called verkshöjd, if it's uniqueness to something, then you have a copyright to it. But people tend to copy, you know, game look and feel and game mechanics. And it's hard to protect copyright in a game. In the US, you can file copyright protection for games, but it's hard to upkeep them. But what you should do is like King did with Candy Crush Saga, whereby they copyrighted the name Candy Crush and Saga for games. So anyone has a game called Candy, there will be infringement in their name. So you protect your game not only through copyright in the name. It's hard to protect. Well, I have a game with blue walls in the third level, and this is a stair going up to a building where you can fight up on a roof. I mean, that's easy to copy and hard to protect.
Thank you.
There's also been an issue also with likeness. I mean, now some people, and Lindsay Lohan sued, was like GTA 5, right? There's a character with a bikini who looked kind of like her. But she lost the case because. But if you make it too close to somebody, it looks too much like a famous person. Then you might get sued.
Yeah, and there's a question over there later.
Okay. So you know, games are deployed on many platforms and they are consumed by players all over the world. So for a small company, I mean, it seems to be the safest thing is to hire lawyers in many countries, or is it doable with only one lawyer that will have expertise? I mean, there is a huge coverage to...
That question is excellent, because, you know, the laws are different in each country, in US is different in each state, so it depends. I mean, normally, in video games, you build your contracts, and you negotiate between two parties, like a publisher, developer, like the contract becomes a Bible. So you put everything like the definitions, by this we mean that, by this we mean that. So normally the contract will govern the party's rights and obligations. I went to law school here in Sweden. We buy a big book called the Law Book, like 2,000 pages of laws, right? You had that, the student, you look in for the laws, what the law says. The last 20 years I have not bought one single law book because everything is in the contract. That's the first thing. But then it depends. If in the local laws implied here, say perhaps you're going to release your game in Japan, or in the local laws in Japan you need to be aware of for the terms of use and for privacy policy, or in special personal data laws that you need to be aware of. So I mean, in the past, you normally do one terms of use, one privacy policy worldwide for your game. But now with GDPR here, there tend to be an issue now about this, and I think right now we're talking about localize the privacy policies and terms of use for each country or many countries, and then I mean, how do you have the correct personal data privacy policy for France? You probably need to ask a French attorney for that. So I mean, that's more and more the way it's going. So the contract itself for game development, normally you have an attorney who knows video game contracts. But for GDPR issues, for same thing, in Germany you cannot have red blood, right? You have a green blood. You cannot have a swastika on Nazi soldiers. You gotta change the logo, you gotta change the blood to be green. And for you have those kind of questions, you probably need to ask a local attorney if you don't know it yourself. Or if you have a publisher, the publisher work job to know that. But sometimes, depending on what your game is looking for, if your game has gambling elements, people can gamble in the game, then you need probably say, is this legal in the markets where the game is going to be published? Can we have a gambling betting in a game being released maybe in Sweden, Norway, and so have you? So it depends. And that was a good answer, but it's a broad answer to a good question, a very tricky question. Any question from Jacob, perhaps? And you can stump us here. And
we have there. Tommy, you have there.
Yeah.
Hi. I have a question about fair use. Like, because as I understand it, parody law, for example, in America is quite permissive. But say you make a parody of, I don't know, Mickey Mouse, and Disney comes and says, stop that or we sue. Even though technically you're operating under fair use, you still have to go to court and pay for an attorney and stuff like that. Is there any way to protect yourself if you suspect you will be infringing legally on a copyright before the fact?
Get a license. Because the advice is never use anything for fair use. With fair use, it's more basically that, you know, what's reasonable and what people do in like in films, you can have a sweeping panorama scene where the camera sweeps over maybe a street corner And you can see in the building 7-Eleven sign, there's a Volvo, someone working coming down with a Nike cap and have an Adidas t-shirt and drinking Coca-Cola. In film, that's accepted. You can film a scene in a city. But in video games, you do things by hand. You animate, you program the walls, the buildings, the cars, the people, the hats, the soft drink. Then you need a license. So, I mean, there's no fair use, really. You need to have a license. I mean, one advice I get from a publisher not too long ago, do not use any open fonts for game manuals in the game. Buy a font with a font license. Then someone has shown you to have a right to that font. Same thing with I mean, if you want to have a gun, you want to have a Smith & Wesson, you need to have a Smith & Wesson license. Because if you do a Smith & Wesson look-alike gun, you'd be infringing. If you do a cop car in New York, you cannot have NYPD. In films, you can sweeping film scenes as NYPD in a cop car going by. But in games, you program it by hand, by decision, by conscious decision. Then you need to either write police, which is general, or get an NYPD license. So never think about fair. Even sometimes you have a common, you have the public commons in the U.S. Sometimes someone had a license on something copyright, and it did not prolong it. So I mean. TNT movies on cable shows a lot of old movies from the 50s. Those movies are open because they were not protected. Gone with the Wind, I guess someone missed protect, so that movie's open. But normally, do not take a chance. Get a license or do like the Star Wars model, make 7 significant changes to a car, to a person's face, so make it unrecognizable. Never take a risk.
Do you have any more questions?
Who do I build from this?
Everything is clear.
So be sure, never guess. Make sure you know your rights. Can I use this model? Can I use this face of a character? Can I use this type of car? Or if not, change your model, change your car, make it non-infringing.
And if you want to have some, if you think about something later, the email addresses is very easy, so I think you remember it. So you just send away a mail and just ask what you're thinking about and discuss things with us. So thank you so much for coming here and listening to us.